Welcome to the Washington Week Extra. I'm Robert Costa. Let's pick up that conversation about the 2020 campaign. The contest is now narrowed to former Vice President Joe Biden and Senator Bernie Sanders, but the eventual nominee will have to unite a fractured party, possibly with a vice presidential pick. Joining me now is Abby Phillip, political correspondent for CNN, and Jonathan Martin, national political correspondent for the New York Times. Jonathan, Abby, thanks for sticking around for the extra. Look, it's a long way away, the VP pick. We don't even know who the nominee is going to be. But if it's Biden, who do you think?
Definitely someone younger. I mean, I do think that he really has to reassure people about the fact that he is older and needs someone who is vibrant, who has a bright future ahead of them. I'm not so sure, you know, VP picks, I think, are a little bit overblown, but I think he wants to signal toward the future of the Democratic Party. So, I think an African-American woman, Kamala Harris, Val Demings, both options that I think people have brought up in the past, yeah. but he doesn't, you know, I don't necessarily think that he needs a sort of, younger white man. I mean, I think a lot of people might have thought that a Pete Buttigieg would be a natural sort of complement to him, but Biden doesn't need to double down on Biden. I think he needs someone who complements him in different ways and can kind of energize the younger portion of the Democratic Party that's just looking for the next generation of leaders.
Has the Biden campaign, Jonathan, started to think through it even informally? A little bit?
I'm sure it's in the back of their minds, and I'm sure Biden's thought about it as he talks to some of these people. But, Bob, they're so busy trying to scale up for this primary and trying to sort of catch their breath after the last few days. I'm not sure that there's any serious planning. But yeah. I think Biden's got to decide how he wants to approach this. I mean, obviously, a governing pick is important, somebody that you can work with that can take over the country if need be, obviously is central. But also, does he want to, you know, try to placate the left if he does defeat Bernie Sanders, and obviously that could be a challenge? Would he want to reward and honor African-American voters, which are both the most loyal base in the party and the folks that basically saved his candidacy in South Carolina and then on Super Tuesday? Or does he want to try to help with voters that he has not done as well with, Hispanic voters, yeah, that Sanders has done better
with? Who could be someone for Biden who's Hispanic?
So there are a couple of names that I have heard. Catherine Cortez Masto, the senator from Nevada, was floated to me a few months ago by Congressman Phillip Vela from Texas. She's a first-term senator and is somebody that could be looked at from Nevada. Michelle Lujan Grisham is the governor of New Mexico, was in the House before she became governor, is, I think, somebody that could also be looked at. Those two states, Bob, Nevada, New Mexico, sort of the interior West, this is the Democratic future out there. Yeah. These are states that have become bluer, and I think places that Biden would want to look to try to energize those kind of voters.
What about, you mentioned Val Demings, the lawmaker from Florida, part of the impeachment team in the House. She seems to have a rising profile.
She does, and I think that people have been paying attention to her. She comes from a law enforcement background. She is a good presenter. She's an African-American woman. I think a lot of people are taking a second look at her. I mean, she's less known, but so are a lot of these people that we are talking about here. This is going to need to be someone who can pretty quickly jump into a national profile and perform. She seemed to prove that with her performance in the impeachment hearings. I think her toughness, yeah, is going to be really important with a kind of a second-tier Democratic message, which is going to be about the issue of corruption with President Trump. They're going to need, I think it would be beneficial to Biden to have someone who can prosecute that case. And that could be a Val Demings. It could also be a Kamala Harris.
That's a good point. By the way, when she was in the Senate prosecuting the impeachment case, she caught the eye of one Charles E. Schumer, Democrat of New York, who was telling people as recently as last week that he thinks that she could be a good pick for Biden.
Yeah.
So I think that's fascinating. Look,
what about Senator Warren? She's sitting out there.
I was going to say, you know, traditionally, those who were the kind of runners-up in campaigns often, yeah, get a long look. And I think this is going to be no different. I think Kamala Harris will get a look. I think Klobuchar will get a look. And I think Warren's going to get a real look.
Okay, what about for Senator Sanders? If he's the nominee, does he go left-left, or does he move to the center with his pick?
I think he's got to move to the center. He's got to find someone who can help him. And in fact, in some ways, I do think a Warren VP would actually be an okay option for Bernie Sanders because, again, Warren is viewed as a progressive, but her base of supporters, these are Hillary voters, they're Biden voters, they're Buttigieg, they're people who's second choice in Iowa and New Hampshire.
But he struggled with African-American voters, maybe Val Demings or Stacey Abrams or Senator Harris.
Exactly. I mean, if any of them would do it. One of the challenges, though, is that some of these people view Bernie Sanders as just not being ideologically similar enough. It's about the tone. I've heard this from Kamala Harris, friends of Kamala Harris, that she, you know, respects Bernie Sanders, but they do not necessarily see eye to eye in approach to politics. That's going to be a real
problem.
Wouldn't
you be surprised, though, if someone turned down the VP offer?
It would be surprising, but I mean, and everybody has, you know, you never know what people are going to do until it's offered to them, and I think people tend to say yes.
What about a unity ticket, Sanders-Biden, Biden-Sanders? I mean, that's what happened in 1980. Yeah. Reagan brought on George H.W. Bush.
Yeah. I think you'd be doubling down on the geriatric base there,
yes.
Bob. I'm not sure the country is ready for 79 and 78 by 2021, which is what they would be. I think it's a long shot.
Yeah, one big question I have, though, as we go into these industrial Midwestern states is, does Biden actually perform with white working class voters, white working class men? That's been his calling card for a long time, and it hasn't been tested yet. If he does perform well, he's probably in good shape, and he can double down on some other parts of the Democratic coalition. But if he does not, that's when I think maybe we start looking at someone from the Midwest.
Gretchen Whitmer.
Exactly, like Michigan's.
So literally this afternoon, I was speaking to a state senator from Detroit, and he told me preemptively, by the way, preemptively, he said, you guys are missing the story. He said, I'm telling you right now, Gretchen Whitmer makes perfect sense to be Biden's running mate because not only is she Michigan, a key state, but she is the kind of Democrat that suburban moderate women flocked to in her campaign in 2018, and she could help Biden with that crucial demographic in 2020. It would cement those voters and give Biden the White House. So that's definitely a possibility.
I mean, it could be a twofer because it would be the suburban women and also the sort of Midwestern you know, vote, which is, you know, for Biden could be very important, but it really does depend on whether on his own Biden has enough juice to kind of get through it. Because if he does, then they really ought to work on turnout in the Democratic base, progressives, minority voters, and the like.
And Whitmer, lastly, was smart to get her endorsement of Biden before the primary,
yes,
by the
exactly.
way.
Yes, exactly. Just under the radar.
I know it's far away, but there's nothing better sometimes than vice presidential speculation, the
totally
veep stakes.
If you're, but it's still fun.
It's fun. That's it for this edition of the Washington Week Extra. You can listen wherever you get your podcasts or watch on our website while you're there. Check out our weekly quiz, the Washington Weekly News Quiz. I'm Robert Costa. Thanks for joining us. See you next time.